Charles University of Prague. He has an impressive list of honors, awards, and distinctions for his scientific contribution to the numerical and mathematical analysis fields. Just to mention a few of them, he has been invited more than 100 times to deliver plenary lecture at established conferences, including an invitation for to the International Congress of Mathematics in Madrid in 2006. He serves generously the community, acting as editor-in-chief and associate editor of many journals. In particular, he's a co-editor-in-chief of the prestigious IMA Journal of Journal of Numerical Analysis and the London Mathematical Society Lecture Notes Series. He gave impressive and important contribution in many fields of the mathematical and numerical analysis of nonlinear partial differential equation, including discontinuous stabilized methods, adaptive algorithm, and kinetic models. And recently he has started to work to non-Newtonian fluid flow models and implicit constituted material models. So it's a great pleasure to give the stage to Professor Andrew Sulis.
So thank you very much indeed. I'm really honored. It's a great pleasure to be at least virtually in Milano. Of course, I have many friends in Mox. It would have been fantastic to be be there in person, but in the circumstances, as I can see, you are all masked up. This is probably not the best time to travel. So what I wanted to talk to you about today is something I spoke about in the One World Numerical Analysis Seminar, but it just so happened that by accident that day was a public holiday in Germany and Holland, in Austria. I don't know whether it was a public holiday also in Italy. So I don't know how many of you have heard this, how many of you have heard this talk. In any case, so there are two reasons I wanted to talk to you about this topic. So one reason is it concerns biological fluids, and Mox is a world leading place in the numerical modeling in biology. So from that point of view, this seemed to me an appropriate topic. The other reason why I wanted to talk to you about this is because of the name of the Georgi in the first line of the title. In in a few weeks' time, on 25th of October, will be the 25th anniversary of the Georgi's death, unfortunately. It seemed appropriate to talk to you about how the Georgi's work impacted in numerical analysis. Of course, as far as I know, maybe you can tell me otherwise, but as far as I know, the Georgi had no interest in numerical analysis. And in fact, I think while he was active, numerical analysis didn't really exist as a subject as such. So you might be wondering what exactly the Georgi has to do with numerical analysis. So I'll try to explain to you in this talk. So the work that is the core of today's lecture is in a joint paper that was published together with Lars Dieninck. Here, I hope you can see my pointer on the screen. So with Lars Dieninck and Tony Charlet. Lars Dieninck is professor at the University of Bielefeld, and Tony Charlet was my PhD student here at Oxford. This joint paper on which this talk is based was published in the IMA Journal of Numerical Analysis just a couple of months ago in the July issue. The whole question that I want to investigate in this talk arose from a PhD thesis from Petra Pustajowska at the Charles University in Prague, and I happen to be external examiner for her thesis. So Petra was interested in numerical simulations of these chemically reacting fluids that I'm going to talk to you about. She did no analysis as such. So there were really quite a few open questions concerning the convergence of numerical methods for these models that she was investigating. So that's Petra, and the other two guys here, Alexei and Songchan Ko, were my doctoral students here at Oxford. So let me explain to you what this is about, but let's start with something simpler that you will all be familiar with, namely the Navier-Stokes equations, which concern the motion of Newtonian fluids. So the fluids I'm going to talk to you about are non-Newtonian fluids, but let's start by just establishing the equations of motion for Newtonian fluids. So if U is the denotes the velocity and P the pressure of viscous incompressible Newtonian fluid, then at steady state, at least let's forget about time dependence. Everything I say can be generalized to time dependent problems, but for the sake of simplicity, and you will see there are lots of complications in any case, let's ignore time dependence. So at steady state, you have divergence U equal to zero, which is a simplification of the conservation of mass equation when the density is constant in both space and time. And then the second equation is what is usually referred to as the Navier-Stokes equation, is conservation of linear momentum, which is a consequence of Newton's second law. You have a convective term, you have a diffusion term, which is usually written as a Laplace type term, but I think it's physically more appropriate. And from the point of view of the extensions in particular, I'm going to talk about, it's more appropriate to write this Laplace term as the divergence of a stress tensor. And the stress tensor is defined down here. So it's called the deviatric or shear stress, is a constant multiple in the case of Newtonian fluids of d of u, where d of u is the symmetric gradient. So U here is a vector, gradient U is a matrix, a non-symmetric matrix in general. So gradient U plus gradient U transpose is what is called the symmetric velocity gradient. And in the case of the Navier-Stokes model, this symmetric velocity gradient times a constant, this viscosity mu, gives you, and the factor two, gives you the shear stress. So this is a linear constitutive relation. This is called the constitutive relation. It's a linear constitutive relation between the deviatric stress and the symmetric velocity gradient with a constant viscosity mu here. So the fluids I would like to talk to you about are called synovial fluids, and they are present in your joints, in movable joints. So in your elbow, in your wrist, in the cavities that are present in these joints, so such as the one that you see in this picture, is populated by the synovial fluid. So the synovial fluid is a non-Newtonian fluid. And if you look at this picture, it's sort of not a very pleasant looking fluid, but it does not behave like water, as you can see from this picture already. So it is composed of ultrafiltered blood plasma and a polymeric substance called hyaluronan. And it is modeled by quite a bit more complicated constitutive relation than in the case of the Navier-Stokes equation. So what happens here is this linear constitutive relation that we had in the case of the Navier-Stokes equations is replaced by a nonlinear constitutive relation. And this nonlinear constitutive relation will depend on two things. It will depend on the magnitude of the symmetric velocity gradient, d of u. This is a matrix and this is a norm of that matrix. So that's one thing the viscosity depends on. The second thing it depends on is C here, which is the concentration of hyaluronan in the fluid. So what exactly is this constitutive relation? Well, here are some examples. So remember, once again, in the case of the Navier-Stokes equation, this S, the deviatric stress was 2 mu times d of u. And now you have this complicated stuff inserted in the middle, which depends on the magnitude of the symmetric velocity gradient. There are some positive constant, kappa 1, kappa 2, which come from data fitting in laboratory experiments. And then there's an exponent here, this R of C, which depends on the concentration, and R again is a given function which comes from data fitting by fitting the concentrations to this power law exponent. So these data fittings indicate that these two functions here, which depend pretty much the same way, are appropriate in these contexts. So R of C is this exponent here. Now, okay, so what is the problem? The problem is that the C is not a given function. So therefore, this R of C is not a given function either, even though R is given as a function of C, because C is not given, R of C is not given either. So why is C not given? C is not given because C is a solution of another partial differential equation, which also involves the velocity, which in turn is the solution of the Navier-Stokes equations. So you have this coupling of the Navier-Stokes system to this concentration equation, and the solution of this concentration equation influences in a rather terrible way, I should say, through this exponent R of C, this shear stress which enters into the Navier-Stokes equation. So I hope, unfortunately, I can't communicate with you. I understand the volume is turned off at, the audio is turned off at your end, but I hope it's clear. Okay, so far so good, thank you. Okay, so let me continue. So if the concentration were, let's say, identically zero, which it isn't, but if you imagine that the concentration is identically zero, if C is zero, e to the power zero is one, one minus one is zero, so then R of C, if C is identically zero, is identically two. And if R of C is identically two, two minus two is zero, so you have this factor here being one, and you are back to the Navier-Stokes model. So if the concentration were identically zero, the model would collapse to the Navier-Stokes model. But in general, it doesn't, because C is not going to be identically two. So what is R of C going to look like? Well, if you look a little bit at these functions, you can see, because the concentration is positive or non-negative in general, this factor here is going to be negative. Because C is positive, this guy is going to be less than one. So you have something that is negative. So you are taking something negative away from two. So R of C will be strictly less than two, and similarly here. So in both of these data fitting models, R of C is going to be between one and two. From the mathematical point of view, the problem really is the following. So if R of C were identically two, and you were back to the Navier-Stokes equations, the usual weak formulation of the Navier-Stokes equations would be in familiar Sobolev spaces in W12. So this two is associated with this two here. So the fact that R of C is two and the model collapses to Navier-Stokes in this case has to do with W12 being, that is H1 being a suitable function space. But because this exponent R of C is no longer two, you end up in some very, very exotic function spaces where instead of this exponent two, you have a variable exponent R of C, which is not even given to you. It depends on some function C, which is the solution of another partial differential equation. So you end up in having to formulate the weak formulation of your problem in these variable exponent Sobolev spaces where this differentiability order is one, but the integrability order, this R, depends on where exactly you are located in the domain. And this R of C varies between one and two, depending on your location in the domain. I hope that that too is clear. Is that okay so far? Great, okay, thank you. So now if you start to look into the theory of these variable integrability Sobolev spaces, it transpires that you can't just stick in any old crazy function in this R of C here. There must be some sort of regularity on this exponent here in the definition of your Sobolev space so that these Sobolev spaces are meaningful. This function R, which is a function of C, which is a function of X, cannot be just a terrible function. There has to be a certain regularity of this function here. So in our case, this R is a very smooth function of C. That's not a problem. The problem really is that C itself is a solution of another partial differential equation, and that partial differential equation depends on U. And U is just a weak solution of the Navier-Stokes equation. So the problem is that you don't really have much regularity of U, and because you don't have much regularity of U, because U is just the weak solution of the Navier-Stokes equation, you don't really get much in terms of regularity of the function C either. So if you look into the theory of these variable order Sobolev spaces, it turns out that there is some kind of minimum regularity that this composite function has to have so that these variable order Sobolev spaces are meaningful. And this minimum regularity is something called log Hölder continuity, which is weaker than Hölder continuity, but it's stronger than uniform continuity. What this log Hölder continuity is, it doesn't matter for the moment. The only thing to remember is that a sufficient condition for this log Hölder continuity is Hölder continuity. So if you have Hölder continuity, that guarantees log Hölder continuity. So the idea is the following. If you could somehow guarantee Hölder continuity of this function C, because R is a smooth function of C, this composite function R of C would also be Hölder continuous, and therefore log Hölder continuous, and therefore you would be in a function space at least for which there is meaningful theory. So that's the problem from the point of view of PDE analysis. From the point of view of numerical analysis, of course, the problem is that you will be approximating this function C with perhaps a piecewise linear function. And C will be being approximated by a continuous piecewise linear function. The numerical approximation of C will be a Lipschitz continuous function. So it will be Hölder continuous. So therefore, because R is a smooth function of C or CH, the numerical approximation, this composite function, even with the numerical approximation, will be even Lipschitz continuous, and therefore Hölder continuous, and therefore log Hölder continuous. So that's not a problem. The problem from the point of view of numerical analysis is to ensure that you have a uniform bound on this composite function, because otherwise you can't prove convergence. So from the point of view of numerical analysis, the question is how to guarantee a uniform Hölder norm bound on the sequence of piecewise linear approximations of the function C. So is this clear? Okay. So this is really the place where the Georgie will come in, but let me press on. So the question from the point of view of numerical analysis is how to ensure that C is Hölder continuous and this numerical approximation is Hölder continuous and you have a uniform Hölder bound on this expression here. So let me just go back 121 years and talk about Hilbert's 19th problem, because this really is the problem that the Georgie solved. So what is Hilbert's 19th problem? What Hilbert was asking in a lecture at the International Congress of Mathematicians in Paris in 1900 was the following: are solutions to regular problems in the calculus of variations always analytic? And what Hilbert meant by this problem was the following. So suppose you have an energy minimization problem, a minimization problem of this sort. You have a given function, and this function f is super smooth. Let's suppose that f is an analytic function in all of its arguments. And you're minimizing this functional, and let's suppose that, just a few words about the notation. So p here is the partial derivative of the function u you are looking for with respect to x, and q is the partial with respect to y. So you have such a minimization problem. You have this condition here, which is basically ellipticity of the associated Euler-Lagrange equation or convexity of the function f, because this is basically positivity of the Hessian. You are assuming that f is an analytic function of all of its arguments. And Hilbert's question was, is it true then that that the minimizer of this minimization problem is going to be an analytic function of x and y? So concerning this question, the first piece of progress was done by Bernstein in 1904, who managed to show that if there is a solution to the problem and the solution is C3 regular, then through a bootstrapping argument, it can be shown that the C3 solution is in fact an analytic function. The important thing to emphasize here is that Bernstein assumed the existence of a C3 solution. So this was an assumption. If a C3 solution exists, then it is analytic. So there was subsequent work by Hoff in 1932, who managed to lower the regularity in Bernstein's argument and showed that, in fact, if you have C2 alpha, so the second derivative is alpha Hölder continuous, then in fact that solution is going to be analytic. So then Guido Slampakia further lowered that result to C1 alpha solution. So he showed that if there is a C1 alpha solution, then that solution must be analytic. And then Moret further weakened it to C1 solutions. But so the answer would be positive to Hilbert's question, but the question remained, there was a gap in this argument, whether these solutions exist. The problem being that the direct method in the calculus of variations merely guarantees the existence of weak solutions in Sobolev spaces. So you have absolutely no guarantee that the minimizer of this variational problem, which you guarantee by using things like weak law semi-continuity and such stuff in the calculus of variations, has any of these differentiability properties that were hypothesized above. So there was a gap in proving Hilbert's 19th problem. And this really is the contribution of De Giorgi. Incidentally, De Giorgi got his doctorate in 1950, I think, at La Sapienza in Roma. Mauro Piccone was the advisor. So nearly 6 years after the completion of his doctorate, he managed to prove this really incredible result, which filled the gap between these results up here and the question that Hilbert was asking. So John Nash, just a year later, and independently proved a similar result in the context of parabolic equations, and then Jürgen Moser gave a different proof. So these are the three persons whose photos are down here. So this here is De Giorgi. So what De Giorgi showed was the following. So he considered the Euler-Lagrange equation associated with this functional. And the idea that he had was basically simple. If you differentiate the Euler-Lagrange equation, then the partial derivatives of the minimizer, which is the solution of the Euler-Lagrange equation, these partial derivatives, in fact, satisfy a linear elliptic equation. So if you can prove C alpha regularity of solutions of this linear elliptic equation, because partial derivatives solve this linear elliptic equation, it turns out that partial derivatives will be C alpha regular, and therefore the solution itself will be C one alpha regular. And then by previous results, by Stampakia, basically you complete this proof of Hilbert's problem. So the main idea, therefore, that Stampakia had was to go via, sorry, that De Giorgi had to, it was to go via Stampakia results. So here's the statement of De Giorgi's theorem in the form that is in the book by Bensusan and Fraser. So you have a linear elliptic partial differential equation minus divergence of some matrix A. I'm writing C for the solution because in the context of the problem we are considering, this is going to be a concentration equation with some terrible coefficient here, which is influenced by the solution of the Navier-Stokes equation. So generally this function A will be just an L infinity function. And on the right-hand side of this linear elliptic partial differential equation, you have a source term, which can be terrible. This is some kind of distributional divergence of a function F, which is in LP perhaps, and then you have another function G, which is in Lebesgue spaces. So looking at such a partial differential equation, and the question is the solution Hölder continuous? And the result is in this theorem here, we don't have to go through the details. There are some technical assumptions. Here's the weak formulation of the problem. And what the result says that in addition to the usual Sobolev regularity, you have uniform Hölder regularity of the solution up to the boundary, where the bound depends on the various pieces of data, the L infinity norm of this matrix A, and so forth, various Lebesgue norms of the data. So this is basically De Giorgi's result. And so the question from the numerical analysis point of view is whether such a result has a discrete counterpart. Is it possible to prove that if I give you a linear elliptic partial differential equation, such as above, and we approximate it with linear piecewise, continuous piecewise linear functions, so instead of C, you have C sub H, is it possible to show that C sub H, now the numerical approximation, satisfies such a bound? So this is the question that we'd like to understand. So here it is again, a key question from the point of view of numerical analysis is how to prove uniform, and by uniform, I mean uniform with respect to the mesh size, Hölder norm bounds on the sequence of continuous piecewise affine finite element approximations of a solution of such a partial differential equation, which is a linear, completely nice linear partial differential equation. The only thing that is unpleasant about it is the fact that this function A here is merely in L infinity. And these guys, F and G, are in some Lebesgue spaces. So I don't know whether the question is clear. Is it okay so far? Okay, thanks. So the contribution here is basically, yes, the answer to that question is yes, it is possible to prove such a result. So this is in this paper that I mentioned with Lars Dieninger and Tony Sharley, published this year, Uniform Hölder Norm Bounds for Finite Element Approximations of Second Order Elliptic Equations in IMA Journal of Numerical Analysis. And if you look at problems of this kind and what people have attempted, it surprisingly little in the literature. There is one paper that I'm aware of, and I've spoken to several other people, including Ricardo Nocetto, who Aguilera mentioned here was the supervisor of. So Ricardo was supervised by Aguilera, Nestor Aguilera in Argentina. So there's a paper by Aguilera and Caffarelli, which prove uniform C alpha, so in H uniform C alpha bounds on continuous piecewise linear approximations of this equation. Laplacian C is equal to zero. Unfortunately, this is not good enough for us because we have a much more complicated equation. We have a source term on the right-hand side. We have a diffusion coefficient here, which is not identically one. Certainly, we don't have a Laplacian C. So this result of Aguilera and Caffarelli could not, unfortunately, in the context we're looking at, be used. There's a further sort of technical issues that they assumed quasi-uniformity, shape regularity of the triangulation, and the triangulation was also assumed to be uniformly acute. So there were some fairly strong technical assumptions on the regularity of the grid. So what was achieved in our paper is an extension of this result by Aguilera and Caffarelli to a more general partial differential equation of the kind that we have for the concentration equation. And we also managed to get rid of the quasi-uniformity assumption and this uniform acuteness assumption on the triangulation. So this is what is written down here. So we do not require uniform acuteness of the triangulation, and we do not need quasi-uniformity of the triangulation either, which is useful because you can work with graded triangulations should you wish to do so. So if you are not familiar with these terms of acute and uniformly acute triangulations, I've inserted the definition on this slide here. So in the case of Laplace's equation, this A matrix would be the identity matrix. And you may have seen these conditions. So you would say that your triangulation is non-obtuse when A is identically the identity matrix. So you take this to be the identity matrix. In that case, this is called non-obtuseness condition. And this condition down here, if A is the identity matrix, is called uniform acuteness condition. And this is the condition that Aguilera and Caffarelli used. In our case, the situation is more complicated because we have this A matrix here. So we have a generalization of these conditions. So we have A non-obtuseness with the A matrix sitting in here and A uniform acuteness. This second condition is the one that we do not need. What we need is this weaker condition, which is with an A here rather than the identity matrix. So the psi here are the continuous piecewise linear basis functions associated with the ith node and the jth node of the triangulation. So you might be wondering whether such triangulations exist. And if this is the question that you are interested in, there's a nice paper by Juan Casado Diaz, Thomas Chacon-Rebolo, Vivek Giraud, Macarena Marmol and François Murat in 2006 in Numerische Mathematik, where they investigate precisely this question, how to construct such A non-obtuse or A acute triangulation. So such triangulations can be shown to exist. So in the proof, we need a technical assumption on this function F that appears on the right-hand side. So the divergence of this capital F appears on the right-hand side of our partial differential equation. I have absolutely no idea how to remove this assumption, whether it's important or unimportant. Well, we need it in the proof. I do not know presently whether it can be removed. And the assumption is the following. So given this function f, whose divergence is on the right-hand side of this linear elliptic partial differential equation, we need to assume the existence of what we call the dominating function g, such that in the sense of negative Sobolev spaces, the divergence of g plus and minus f is less or equal than zero. it's obviously if f is identically zero, this is easy to satisfy, and you can think of other simple situations when this assumption can be satisfied. As I said, I do not know whether this technical assumption can be removed. So here's the theorem. Again, we don't have to go through the details. The main result is the following, that under reasonable assumptions on the data, and in particular A here, this coefficient matrix is just an L infinity matrix, we have a uniform Hölder bound on the sequence of continuous piecewise linear approximations to the solution of this linear elliptic partial differential equation. So let me just pause for a moment, and is this still okay? Are you still with me? Okay. So I'll explain in a moment why exactly we needed such a result. You might be wondering, why the hell do I care about these uniform Hölder bounds on the solution? But I'll come to the point. So I'll come to the point in a second. So let's talk about, let's go back to the original problem. Let's talk about a finite element approximation of our original partial differential equation. And this is this PhD thesis from Prague that I mentioned that motivated my interest in this field. If you are interested in it, it's still available from this website. So Petra was a postdoc at Graz for a while, and then she moved to the group of Barbara Wollmuth in Munich, and now I think she works in industry, in car industry, some company. So she's given up on theoretical numerical analysis, but her thesis is a very nice piece of work, and if you are interested, you will find if you Google it. So then with her and my doctoral student Songchan Ko, we worked on the convergence analysis of this, but this was at a time when these uniform Hölder bounds were not available, so we had to go through various acrobatics in order to be able to prove convergence of the finite element approximations. I don't really want to get into the details, because what I'm going to tell you now are much stronger results than what we managed to prove at the time. So incidentally, if you are interested in exotic Sobolev spaces, if you want to live in these crazy exotic Sobolev spaces, look at the book of Mihail Ruzicka, who is interested in electrorheological fluids. And in the context of these electrorheological fluids, these weird variable order function spaces also appear. So he has a nice book about this, Springer book. So let me go back to my problem. So you have divergence u equal to zero, as in the case of the Navier-Stokes equation. You have this conservation of linear momentum, as in the case of the Navier-Stokes equation. But now this function s is not a constant multiple of d of u. It's this complicated expression that I showed you earlier on. And then you have this concentration equation, which involves the velocity field. And then the concentration, as I mentioned to you, enters into this exponent R of C, which is present in the definition of this shear stress tensor. So then you stick in some standard boundary conditions. This is really for the purpose of the analysis. Obviously, if you want to do numerical computations, you can complicate these boundary conditions further. But let's just suppose zero boundary condition for the velocity on the boundary of the domain, and some given boundary data, Dirichlet boundary data for the concentration equation. We assume some reasonable regularity for this boundary. So C boundary data, C of B is a function that is defined on the whole domain, and then you restrict it to the boundary. So this is how the function CB is given to you. So then by Sobolev embedding, because S is greater than D, you have automatically continuity of this function. So you can talk about the minimum and the maximum of this function on the whole domain, the C of B function, which is going to be relevant for what follows. So this is the statement of the problem. And then you have some kind of structural assumptions on the shear stress that appears in the partial differential equation. We don't have to look into the details of this. There's some kind of boundedness assumption. There's a monotonicity assumption. And then there's a coercivity assumption. All of these assumptions are satisfied in the case of this weird stress tensor that we are dealing with. So this R here for us will depend on the concentration C. So instead of C here, I write Xi. And this R of C or R of Xi of ours has to be strictly and uniformly greater than one, bounded below by some number r minus, and strictly bounded from above by r plus. This condition is going to be important in these variable order Sobolev spaces, because this is yet another property that you have to have in order for this function space, variable order Sobolev space, to have reasonable properties. So I label this two star, this assumption. And then you have the Hölder conjugate of R, the usual notation, and this R prime enters here. So this is some kind of coercivity assumption. And as I said, all of these assumptions are satisfied in our case. And then for the flux in the concentration equation, this is the convective flux. Again, you have some assumptions which we don't have to worry about. These will be satisfied in any decent model that you may be interested in. So going back to my examples, so in our case, as I mentioned before, this mu coefficient that pre-multiplies d of u has this form. I mentioned this before, and this r of c for us is either this function or this function. So I'm going to refer this this guy, I'm going to refer to as model 2a, and I'm going to refer to this model as 2b. This is the terminology that was used in Petra Pustayovskaya's PhD thesis, so I follow this terminology. The reason for this reference is I'm going to show you some pictures so that you understand what exactly I'm referring to. So this is model 2a, and this is going to be model 2c for 2b for this coefficient r of c. So what do these exponents look like? So clearly, in the case of the Navier-Stokes equation, when r of c is identically 2, 2 minus 2 is 0. So this is going to be the exponent of this factor in this viscosity coefficient that we have. So if r of c is identically 2, n of c is 2 minus 2, that's 0. So this exponent will be identically 0. If you move away from the Navier-Stokes model, so if you have model 2a or model 2b, you have these exponents which vary throughout the computational domain. So as you can see, these are not constant functions. So this exponent varies then throughout the domain. So let me tell you just a few words about these variable order Sobolev spaces. So I'm not sure whether you have come across these spaces before. So just to give you a little bit of intuition without going into the details. So how do you define a variable order Lebesgue space? So instead of putting a constant exponent, you now have an R of X here, which varies from your location in the domain. So as long as this expression is finite, you say that you are in this variable order Lebesgue space. And the norm on this space is defined by this expression here, which may look weird when you first see it. But if you think about it for a moment, you'll see the intuition. So imagine for a moment that R of X is constant. So R of X is identically R. If R of X is identically R, then lambda is raised to a constant exponent R. So lambda to the power r can be kicked across to the other side. So you have u of x in modulus raised to the power r being integral less than or equal than lambda to the power r. You take the rth root of that, and then what you have is that the standard Lebesgue norm, when you take the rth root, should be less or equal than lambda. And you're looking for the smallest lambda that satisfies this bound. And that is precisely the Lebesgue norm of a function. So what I'm saying is that if R of X is identically R, this so-called Luxembourg norm is in fact the standard Lebesgue norm in the space. So this is the intuition behind these definitions. And then once you have these, you can define these variable order Sobolev spaces where you put the gradient into this variable order Lebesgue space, and W1 with this variable integrability order would be defined by this Luxembourg norm, analogously as for these Lebesgue spaces above. So it turns out that I mentioned to you this property 2 star, that R of X is strictly bounded from 1 and is strictly bounded from infinity. This is very important because it turns out that if R of X is strictly bounded away from 1 and infinity, these variable order Sobolev spaces are still Banach spaces, and they are separable and they are reflexive, which is important. So then these are sort of the usual function spaces that you would encounter if you have zero Dirichlet boundary conditions or divergence free functions as you have in these weak formulations. For the pressure, you need a function space. Also, because the pressure is only determined up to a constant, you factor out this arbitrary constant in the usual way by demanding that the integral average is zero. So remember at the start of the talk, I mentioned this weird condition, this log-Hölder continuity. And now I'm telling you what this condition is. So here it is. So what this exponent R is required to satisfy is this condition here. And this is what is called log-Hölder continuity. A sufficient condition for this is that a function is Hölder continuous. So here's the weak formulation of the problem. Again, nothing particularly exciting about this. It looks like a standard weak formulation for the Navier-Stokes equation. The only difference is that you put your solution into this variable order function spaces for the velocity and the pressure. The existence of solutions to this problem is proved in these papers. So these are PDO analysis papers in the elliptic case and in the case of also partial parabolic partial differential equations. So we are interested in the finite element approximation, and this again looks like a completely standard finite element approximation for the problem. You just replace u with uh and the test function v with vh, and you go through the usual motions in terms of formulating the finite element approximation to the problem. The existence of solutions to this can be shown by a fixed point argument. And the question we are interested in is the convergence of these finite element approximations to a solution, to a weak solution of the problem. So this is the mathematical question that I'm interested in. So again, just a couple of weak formulations. So once again, I'm showing you the computed viscosity for different models. So in the case of the Navier-Stokes model, you have a constant viscosity. This is a power law type model where the exponent is fixed, so it doesn't vary. And you have model 2A and model 2B, where you see these variations in the viscosity coefficient. So let me just explain these numerical simulations. So what you see here, this tiny thing, this thin line, is in fact the computational domain with an aspect ratio 1 to 100. So it's a very anisotropic domain. And what is this bigger thing that you see here is a zoom up, zoom into one corner, this corner here of the computational domain where the aspect ratio is 1 to 10. So this bigger thing is just one corner of this long thin domain. And the same applies down here. So as to be able to see some variation in this thin domain. So these are some further simulations by Alexei Gaskarovsko in Oxford. So these are solutions of the concentration equation in this model with precisely this relationship between the shear stress and the symmetric velocity gradient. And this n of c is this function here. And we solve the concentration equation numerically. So what is being plotted in this picture is the numerical solution of the concentration equation. You have a large Becquerel number, so we have to use SUPG stabilization, Scott-Vogelius elements, P2 for the velocity, P1 discontinuous for the pressure on barycentrically refined meshes and so forth. So the boundary conditions, I mean, it's a lid-driven cavity problem for the velocity. There's a velocity field on the top, which is given by this expression. It's equal to zero in the two corners. The boundary condition for the velocity field is zero on the other walls. And then for the concentration equation, we have a fixed Dirichlet boundary condition, 0.3 on the top, zero at the bottom, and zero Neumann boundary conditions at the two ends for the concentration. So that's one numerical simulation. Here's another numerical simulation where the model is with a fixed exponent R. So you can see the difference between the concentration where you have this more complicated model compared to a simple power law type model where this exponent R is fixed. So you can already see the visual difference. So I have three more slides and I'm done. So let me just say a few words about the question that I was personally interested in, is the convergence of the sequence of numerical approximations. So you have existence of solutions to this finite element equations, and you would like to know whether the sequence of numerical approximations converges to anything. So using these various structural assumptions that were assumed, one can prove various bounds on the sequence of finite element approximations to the velocity. This bound on the numerical approximation to the shear stress comes from this coercivity assumption that was assumed for the shear stress and so forth. So you have various bounds. And the one that is really important is the one down here, this fourth line, which comes from this discrete Hölder norm, uniform Hölder norm bound that we managed to prove. So without this fourth bound, I would not have been able to complete the convergence analysis of the numerical method. So this fourth line, simple as it may look, is the most important bound in this whole thing. So once you have these various bounds on the sequence of numerical approximations, you know from standard results in functional analysis that you have a weakly convergent subsequence of the sequence of numerical approximations in a certain standard Sobolev space. Remember, this R minus was the lower bound on this variable order exponent R of C. Then by compact Sobolev embedding, you have strong convergence in a Lebesgue space from this bound on the previous slide, this one here on the shear stress. You have weak convergence of these approximations to an object that needs to be identified. So this guy weakly converges to something, but you don't know what that something is. That something is to be identified. The approximate pressures also converge to a pressure weakly in a Lebesgue space. So then the concentrations also weakly converge. This is no surprise because you have a uniform bound on the gradients of the concentrations. So this inequality here comes from there. The sequence of these convective fluxes in the concentration equation also converges weakly to something, Q tilde, which needs to be identified. So this identification of these weak limits is really the most technical part of the proof. So you would like to say that what you have converged to, this S tilde, is S of C and D of U, but this is not clear. And similarly down here, what you would like to say is that this Q tilde is Q sub C of C, gradient C and D of U. But again, this is not clear because you have weak convergence and nonlinearity, and weak convergence don't go together nicely. So it's difficult to pass the limit just using weak convergence in nonlinearities. So what comes to the rescue is really this strong convergence in these Hölder norms, which is a direct consequence of these Hölder norm bounds on the concentration that we have using this new result that we have proved. And this allows us to identify S tilde and Q tilde, the weak limits of these fluxes in the Navier-Stokes equation and in the concentration equation, they are what you expect them to be. So S tilde turns out to be S of C of DU, and Q tilde turns out to be Q of C of gradient C and DU. So what this means is that these objects that you have converged to are in fact weak solutions to the system of partial differential equations. So that is that. I think I'm basically done. So just a few remarks and I'm going to end. So what were the tools that were used in this convergence analysis? I couldn't go into the details because the proofs are really very, very messy. So there was this monotonicity assumption in the nonlinearity in the Navier-Stokes equation or the conservation of linear momentum equation. And because of, thanks to this monotonicity assumption, we were able to use Minty's method from the theory of monotone operators to pass to the limit. Another thing that was needed is something called the discrete Bogovsky operator. So the Bogovsky operator is the inverse of the divergence operator, and you need a discrete counterpart of the discrete divergence So this is this discrete Bogosky operator. In fact, it is even more messy because you need this discrete Bogosky operator in these variable order Sobolev spaces. So then another thing we needed is a technique which is associated with the names of Acerbi and Fusco. It's called Acerbi-Fusco-Lipschitz truncation method, and we needed to develop a discrete counterpart of this Acerbi-Fusco-Lipschitz truncation for finite element approximations in order to be able to pass the limit. So in constant exponent Sobolev spaces, this was done in this earlier paper with Lars Dieninger and Christian Kreutzer published in Sinum, and then we had to extend this to variable exponent Sobolev spaces. So there are a few papers you might be interested in. These two I have mentioned earlier. Much of the stuff that I didn't go into in today's lecture can be found in the PhD thesis of Tony Charlet, which you can download from my homepage in Oxford, and that was all that I wanted to say. So thank you very much indeed for your attention.
Okay, so thank you very much, Andrew, for this very, very interesting talk. Is there any question, comment, or remark? Okay, Alfio?
Maybe start. Thank you very much. André, can you hear me?
Yes, thank you. Yes.
Okay. So maybe more than one question. I'll ask them in a row so that I will keep the microphone as free as possible. So the first question is about the generality of this very intricated power law that you are using, which is a kind of dynamical in the sense that the exponent depends actively on the solution of another equation. If you have seen or you're aware of other contexts apart from this synovial fluid where this power law is appropriate. That's the first question. The second one is about the piecewise linear element that you've been addressing. And I'm wondering if this theory, which is, of course, is terribly complicated as far as I understand, is limited to that because I don't know, maybe you need a kind of discrete maximum principle or you can extend it to a second order or whatever, say. The third question is about the, but this really is a very naive question, the appropriateness of using continuous Navier-Stokes equations for the example that you have been showing where you have this aspect ratio in your computational domain, it's a very thin domain. If it's not, I don't know, more appropriate to use kind of microfluidic approach. And stop here for the time being. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Althea, so concerning your first question, the only context in which I have seen this, and I must say, I'm not a specialist in the area of synovial fluids. The only context in which I have seen this is in the one that I have described. So if there's anything you have come across, I'd be very, very interested in. It seems to me a mathematically very, very exciting problem. It really raises so many technical questions that I have not encountered before. So I find the area very interesting. I have not seen this in any other context. So have you seen these models elsewhere?
Well, I mean, very long ago, we saw some models of this type in biological fluid dynamics for blood flow. But mm-hmm. This is just a matter of, you see, it was a zoo of possible power laws that were used in different contexts that before people somehow agreed on the fact that Carroll-type power law was...
The
debate was very open indeed.
So when was this roughly? Is it possible to look this up somewhere? I mean, I'd be interested.
Let me try to see and try to recover this if possible.
Okay.
Something that's so long ago.
Yeah. I mean, the only context, Alfio, in which I have seen this is the following. So this exponent is variable, but it's a given function. So in our case, this R was a function of C. And if I give you the function C, then R of C, even though C is a variable as a function of X, it's a given function.
Yeah.
So here the complication is that C is a solution of this partial differential equation, so C changes all the time.
I guess it was more used to see this with a variable R, but R was somehow obtained by a fitting method on the basis of observations.
I mean, if you can dig it out, I would be very interested. I would be very interested to see that. So concerning your second question, that's again an interesting question. So yes, you are absolutely right. So it is kind of like a discrete maximum principle. So I mean, if you think of a situation when let's just think about one space dimension. If you have a grid with 2 points and you have a linear function which is positive at the endpoints of the elements, then by linearity, this function is going to be positive throughout the whole element. But if I have a quadratic approximation, it even though it may be positive at the endpoints of the interval, the quadratic can undershoot and it can go negative. So here the problem is basically the same. So this is why we are stuck with linear elements. And the proof of this discrete this discrete Hölder bound is a real mess, really, because what we had to do is go through DeGeorgi's paper. And in DeGeorgi's paper, he's using what are called Cacioppoli estimates. So we had to reproduce these Cacioppoli estimates on the level of finite element approximations. So the problem is that whereas in the context of partial differential equations, you usually have much more freedom than in numerical analysis when you are constrained to working with functions which live on a computational mesh. And this really is a huge mess when you have some property in the world of PDEs, and then you try to reproduce this property discretely. It usually is harder to reproduce this property discretely than to prove it on the level of PDEs. So, I mean, this doesn't directly answer your question, but it already in the case of linear elements, it is a huge mess to prove this. And the third question concerned these long, thin domains. I agree with you. It is questionable whether this model is appropriate for with domains with such aspect ratios. So these computations that I showed you come from this PhD thesis of Pustejovska. So I'm quoting those results from there. So I think it would be interesting to perhaps redo the simulations on I guess more reasonable models on these domains.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other question, Paolo?
My first question was about the discrete maximum.
I think that yes.
Yeah. Do you hear me?
Yes, just about.
Okay. acrobatics. Okay. So my first question was about the discrete maximum principle, but you have already commented from Alfio. So I just ask about a curiosity about these variable exponent Sobolev spaces. Are they related to the more well-known weighted Sobolev spaces? Do you see a connection in between the two, or are they two separate, let's say, zoos, two separate animals?
So I think they are separate animals. You can make these spaces even more complicated by sticking in a weight also in. So if we go back to the definition, if you bear with me for a second while I'm clicking backwards. If we go back to these definitions, so if you can put in a weight in front of between the integral and the function, then you can have also weighted spaces with a variable exponent. So such spaces also exist, but here, this guy is up in the exponent. It's not in front of the function, but it's up in the exponent. So there's some sort of spiritual similarity in that there's some extra complication, but they live in different cages in the zoo.
Okay, thank you very much. That was
thank you.
Okay, is there any other question from home or from the audience, Christian?
Hello, Andrea. Thank you very much. Vergara, and I would like to know if for the unsteady case, you mentioned that, the analysis could be extended, but I would like to know what about the dynamics in the sense that the variables C and U will experience the same dynamics in the sense that they the same time scales or there will be some one of the two that is faster or slower, and so you have to account for this at the numerical level. Thank you.
So that's, thank you very much. That's a very interesting question to which I do not know the answer. The only thing I do know is, and that is in the PhD thesis of Song Chan Ko, which again is on my homepage. So it's in the final chapter of his PhD thesis, is looking at the existence of weak solutions to this problem in the dynamic case. So what is known is that yes, weak solutions to this problem exist, even if the concentration is a function of both space and time, and this crazy function then enters into R, so R depends on C, and C depends on both space and time, so it is a real mess. What is known is that yes, there are weak solutions. What has not been looked at is the analysis of numerical approximations to the dynamic problem. So that's a completely open question. I guess what would be needed in that case is some kind of extension of the result that we have here to the time-dependent case. So you replace this concentration equation with a time-dependent concentration equation, something like a nonlinear heat equation, and then in this dynamic setting, one would need to prove some similar sort of bound, which is held there both in space and in time, and I do not know how to prove such a result. So I think it's a very, very interesting question to which I would love to know the answer. I do not.
Thank you.
Is there any other question or comment? Can I ask Andre?
Yes,
Paola,
of course, Paola.
Can I ask a curiosity and then a question that is somehow linked to the first question of Alfio? So the curiosity is, so you show us different kind of models, like I think you call them model one, model two.
Yes.
Low level question. So how this is connected with the application or with the physics? So which are the links that tells you that you should go for model one or model two or something in between? And
so,
then, sorry.
So let me just try to answer. So both model 2A and model 2B come from data fitting in laboratories.
Okay.
And so if you look into the PhD thesis of Petra, which I think if you Google Petra Pustajowska plus Graz, then you will easily find this PhD thesis. So her background is in polymer chemistry. So she's not an analyst. So she was interested in modeling. She was interested in where these models are coming from, how to fit the data, how to get these exponents and so forth. So there's a very nice explanation in her thesis, how these models are, where these models are coming from, which are appropriate. Frankly, I do not remember whether she made any distinction between model 2A and model 2B, which are these two ones here from the point of view of applications. I don't remember now. I don't remember now, but there should be some information in her PhD thesis.
Thank you.
But I interrupted you. I think you wanted to ask something else.
I have a second curiosity. So going back to, I understood that there's a lot of very complicated theory and somehow conforming P1 elements where, you know, you give all the instruments to go through all the complicated details. So I was wondering whether you see so the potential interest to go for more exotic methods where, for example, you can fit up in the scheme certain physical properties like the incompressibility or constraint or whether some global smoothness can be of any help.
So again, that is a very interesting question, Paula. So I didn't dwell on this, but if you look at the finite element approximation here, you will see that the convection term in this quasi-Navier-Stokes equation has been changed to this one here. So I don't know to what extent this is familiar to the audience. So the reason why this is done, so instead of, so forget about this one half, instead of writing U tensor U gradient of the test function, which would come from partial integration in the convective term. You replace this by one half of this guy and one half of another guy, which comes from another partial integration from this term. So it turns out that if you plug in U here, so UH, so if you take VH to be UH, this is going to be zero. And this is a property that is important in the proof of proof of existence of solutions of the Navier-Stokes equation. So if you look at the Navier-Stokes equation where you have U dot grad U, if you test it with U itself and U is divergence free, then the convection term vanishes. And if you want to reproduce this property on the level of the numerical method, you need to change the convective term to this one here. So this modified convection term inherits this property. And the reason why that is important is because if you want to test this equation here with the velocity field itself, U sub H, then because the velocity field is discretely divergence free, dvuh tested with the pressure will disappear. This will be a nice term for which you have bounds thanks to these various structural properties. And if you take vh to be uh, this term also vanishes. So these bounds that I'm showing you later on, so for example, these bounds directly come from the fact that you can plug in vh equal to uh as a test function and this nasty stuff and the pressure term vanishes. So, and the reason for having to do this change in this expression, the convective term, is because UH here is only discretely divergence free. If UH were pointwise divergence free, so now I'm coming to your question. If UH is pointwise divergence free, then you don't have to do this modification. So it turns out that this modification has a price. In the case of the Navier-Stokes equation, this modification doesn't affect the convergence analysis of finite element approximations. But here, because you are not in the setting of the Navier-Stokes equation, you are working in W1R instead of W12, you need to look at the boundedness of this trilinear form. And the boundedness of this trilinear form is different with this modification. So I don't know whether I'm making this clear. So the fact that you have modified this form has some impact on the boundedness properties of this trilinear form. And so there is a price to pay for this. Whereas if you are working with discretely, not discretely divergence-free, but pointwise divergence-free finite elements, then you don't have to do this modification and you are in a better shape. So this was basically the reason why in these numerical simulations, we use Scott-Vogelius elements on P2, P1 disk with these barycentric refined meshes, because these are pointwise divergence free.
Thank you.
Sorry, this is a long answer to your simple question.
Thank you very much. So is there any other question? Let me check from remotely connected. So if not, so let me thank Andre again for this very, very interesting talk. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.